Welcome, everyone. My name is Fred Kaiser, and I'm your host here at the Fast Team National Resource Center, FAA Production Studios, at the Sun and Fun Complex at Lakeland, Florida. An exciting week we're having so far at Sun and Fun, and more to follow. Today's presenter is a Deputy Federal Air Surgeon. He retired from the Navy as a captain after 30 years of service. He holds several degrees from the University of Oklahoma, including Doctor of Medicine. He is an emeritus member of the Society of Naval Flight Surgeons, where he was president from 2002 to 2003. His topic today is maintaining your medical. And without any further delay, let's welcome Dr. James Fraser.
Well, good morning. It's great to be back at Sun and Fun. This is my third year here to have the opportunity to speak in this venue. Today I'd like to do a couple things. First of all, I'd like to tell you just a little bit about myself so you'll know where I'm coming from. Then I'd like to tell you about what the Office of Aerospace Medicine does. And then lastly, I'd like to get into current issues as it regards how you can maintain your current medical, things that I think you may be interested in. So to start off with, just to give you just a couple seconds about where I come from, just over 5 years ago, I was a happy sailor down in Norfolk, Virginia, still thinking I had 4 years to try to figure out what I wanted to be when I grew up, when the Navy sent me a letter and told me that 30 years was all the time a sailor was allowed to have fun. So after 30 years in the Navy, I was able to apply for my present position at the FAA and made the move from Norfolk, Virginia to Alexandria, Virginia. Same state, different world. I did spend my time in the Navy. Not all of it was as a flight surgeon. I started life as a Mark 1 Mod 0 family physician. And after residency and family practice and sticking around as family practice teaching staff, I went with my family overseas and had tours in the Philippines and in Scotland. I certainly enjoyed my time overseas and as a family physician. Had some great experiences, but I had always wanted to be a naval flight surgeon. So before I turned 40 and got too old to start training, I was able to report to Pensacola, Florida, the source of all things from which naval aviation comes, and did my training as a flight surgeon. They taught me how to fly an airplane, and with flight pay, I got a pay raise, and I've been in aerospace medicine ever since. Following my time as a basic flight surgeon, I was able to stick around Pensacola and do a second residency in aerospace medicine. And then in the Navy, if you do a residency in aerospace medicine, it's pretty much a one-way ticket to an aircraft carrier. So I had the opportunity to serve as the senior medical officer on the USS Theodore Roosevelt, one of our national treasures, one of our nine nuclear aircraft carriers. On the carrier, I had a 67-bed hospital, a medical staff of 70, and we took care of the ship's company and the air wing that comprised 6,000 personnel on the Roosevelt, and then the larger battle group with the destroyers and the amphibious ships thrown in were about 10,000 folks that we oversaw. Well, following my tour on the Roosevelt, I was able to fleet up and be what was called the Force Medical Officer for the Commander Naval Air Force's Atlantic Fleet. And as such, I had oversight of what were then 8 aircraft carriers on the East Coast, all naval flight surgeons and physicians serving in the Atlantic Fleet. And then lastly, I finished my career in the Navy at the Naval Safety Center, where I had the opportunity to provide oversight and train all naval flight surgeons. I had the opportunity to be involved in safety initiatives at the very, very highest levels of the Navy, and I actually finished out my Navy career having the honor to serve on the Columbia Accident Investigation Board. So I feel very fortunate to have had a career in the Navy that I think has served me well for my position as Deputy Federal Air Surgeon. I'd like to tell you now a little bit about the Office of Aerospace Medicine and what we do. Certainly, probably the most important thing we do is develop standards for airmen and air traffic controllers. We serve as the gold standard for the rest of the world in terms of setting these kind of standards that the other medical certificating authorities basically emulate. With that, I'll tell you a quick story just to give you some idea of the way that we are able to serve as the benchmark for the rest of the world. In addition to setting standards, we also determine what medications are safe for airmen and for air traffic controllers. And being the world gold standard, we're relatively conservative. We don't allow experimental drugs. We wait until the FDA approves of a given medication. And then as lots and lots of people begin taking these medicines, we actually wait an additional year to make sure that there's no aeromedically unacceptable side effects. So, a couple years ago, there was a medication that came along named varenicline. Varenicline was a smoking cessation medication, and it showed great promise. Varenicline was effective where other modalities of smoking cessation had failed. And this included hypnotism and nicotine patches, nicotine gum. Now, in case you just dropped in from another planet, smoking is bad for you. So certainly we in aerospace medicine were interested in any medication that could help airmen and air traffic controllers stop smoking. So when varenicline got approved by the FDA, and then it went a year, and it showed no evidence of side effects that would be incompatible with aviation, we allowed it to be used in both airmen and air traffic controllers. However, as is not uncommonly the case, there began to be reports that showed up in the medical literatures two years after approval. And in these reports, people taking varenicline started having episodes of psychosis or suicidal ideation, suicidal thinking. Neither of these are good if you're in a cockpit or if you're a controller controlling traffic. So we met as a group and we looked at the literature that was coming out about these episodes of psychosis or suicidal ideation in patients taking varenicline, and we determined that that was a risk to the national airspace. So we very quickly identified those airmen or controllers that had stated on their last physical that they were taking varenicline, and we were able to notify them within 24 hours. But as you know, you only report medicines at the time you do your physical. Unlike the Navy or the military, you don't go to a flight surgeon or to an aviation medical examiner every time you start a new medicine. So to get the word out to these airmen and controllers, we worked with the alphabet groups, we worked with AOPA, we worked with NATCA, we worked with EAA, we had the word out on electronic bulletin boards, and within the space of 1 week, not only did you see the word out in electronic bulletin boards, but in the Washington Post and the New York Times and various other big publications, it became known, or it was being spread, the word was being spread, that the FAA had declared use of varenicline in airmen and air traffic controllers to be disqualifying. So I thought this was pretty cool. And within that same week, we had some of the representatives from the medical certificating authorities from around the world calling us and asking us why we had discontinued the approval of varenicline, and we would tell them, and then they too would do the same for their airmen and air traffic controllers. So within a week, within the span of 1 week, we had identified a risk to the national airspace, and we had taken actions and basically had very effectively made sure that varenicline wasn't only being used in the United States, but throughout the world. So I went home on a Friday thinking, darn, we're good, you know? Within a week to identify a hazard and to be able to mitigate that risk within such a short a period of time, not only nationwide, but worldwide, we did good work. Then I came back to work on Monday. And one of the first things that I was told was that we had, that aviation safety had been notified by the American Medical Association, and there was a statement that they wished us to respond to. Basically, the American Medical Association said we had caved to the pressures of the tobacco lobby. I was really angry. Not only had I never spoke with, nor would I know what a tobacco lobbyist looked like. I mean, they don't deal with us feds. They go up to Congress up on the Hill. But not only would I not know what a tobacco lobbyist looked like, for anyone without benefits of the facts and data to suggest that we would discontinue a medicine for the sole purpose of allowing airmen and air traffic controllers to continue smoking was just ludicrous. So I was really torched. So I took a few deep breaths, went outside and had a cigarette. Just kidding about the cigarette. So we sent this member of the American Medical Association all the facts and data on which we had made our decision, and we haven't heard anything since. But I tell that quick story just to point out the influence that we, the Office of Aerospace Medicine, have not only in the nation, but throughout the rest of the world. So our first job is to keep the national airspace safe. That's why we develop standards, that's why we look at new medications and things of that nature. But our secondary mission that I'm very proud of, we look to get every airman up that we think we can safely do so. And in order to do that, we authorize special issuances being a waiver for medical conditions that were previously considered as disqualifying. And I'm very proud of the fact that if you will work with us, if you have a disqualifying medical condition, but yet you're willing to work with us in the Office of the Aerospace Medicine, we ultimately final deny only about 0.1% of all airmen. So if you're willing to work with us and undergo the specified follow-up and testing that we may require, the odds of you getting a medical certificate are very, very good. And we'll talk more about that later. We also develop standards for commercial air travel. That's with us now. And we develop standards for operations of UASs, unmanned aerial systems, or unmanned aerial vehicles as it was once known. Certainly a part of our industry that is quite interesting and evolving very rapidly. In the Office of Aerospace Medicine, we give medical certificates. We give 450,000 odd medical certificates per year. At headquarters, we are the appeals level. So for those medicals that might have been denied by the regional flight surgeon or by AMCD in Oklahoma City, the Aeromedical Certification Division in Oklahoma City, those cases ultimately come to the federal air surgeon at headquarters, and we get involved in some of the most interesting medical and psychiatric issues, and certainly go through those cases with a fine-tooth comb, because if we final deny, we have to defend before an administrative law judge at the NTSB. And those guys aren't physicians. They just make sure that we've dotted every I and crossed every T in terms of following all the statutes and all the rules that we have to go by. We're very big in occupational health in the sense that air travel represents a very real risk to the introduction of serious diseases in this country. you can look at the deepest, darkest, scariest places on Earth. And now with the advent of modern air travel, you can get bad things into the borders of the United States within 24 hours. So I have found it very interesting to work with organizations like Homeland Security and CDC and NIH in terms of making sure we work in a coordinated fashion for things such as infectious diseases like TB and SARS, emerging illnesses like the avian flu or Ebola virus, and especially bioterrorism agents like anthrax. And I can tell you that there's some exciting and some scary stuff that goes on out there that you don't read about in your local newspaper. We're also very much into substance abuse or dependence abatement. We have our industry program where we're very active in terms of testing our 121 and our 135 pilots. It doesn't affect most of you folks since you're general aviation. We also have our internal substance abuse program whereby we test our own FAA personnel that are in safety and security sensitive positions, and that's mostly our air traffic controllers. I tell you, it's been an interesting phenomenon to have the substance dependence reinforced upon me as a big issue. I never cease to be amazed at the many thousands of 121 and 135 pilots that either try to go through TSA with alcohol on their breath, and you occasionally read about some of the most egregious cases in your newspaper, but we also test these folks randomly. And most amazing of all to me is the pre-employment testing that DOT requires. If you're going to start work for an aviation entity, 121 or a 135 entity, it's required that you're going to have a drug screen. Now, it's no surprise that that's going to happen. You're told that that's going to happen. And yet, the thousands of pilots that have had years of training and spent many thousands of dollars that undergo this training that have this disease such that they can't stay off of drugs prior to a pre-employment testing just amazes me. So the problems with substance abuse, substance abatement is out there, it's very real, and I never cease to be amazed at how serious a problem that is. One of the things that I'm very proud of, or proud to be a part of, is the programs at the FAA that we have developed many years ago to work with substance abusing or substance dependent pilots. We have a HIMS program. HIMS is Human Interventional Motivation Study. It's a program that was started 30 years ago in conjunction with the unions and with the air carriers and with the FAA. And so with the three of us working together, we have identified substance abusing pilots or substance dependence pilots. It was once a career ender, and because it was a career ender, it would not get mentioned. People would not basically tell us when one of their cohorts had a problem and there was a risk to flight and a risk to passengers. But we now fortunately have a system where you can either self-report, or if you're concerned, and once again I'm talking 121, 130, 135 operations, you can report a fellow crew member, and after treatment and rehabilitation, we are able to successfully get these pilots back to active careers, and they once again are productive members of society. We have returned many thousands of substance abusing and substance dependent pilots to sobriety and to active productive careers, and I'm proud that we now have a lot of AMEs that are specially trained that allow us to work with third class pilots, general aviation pilots. So if there are third class pilots that have third class medicals, we're now able to get them hooked up with the same kind of rehabilitation that we previously had for commercial pilots and get them a medical certificate sooner than the 2 years they'd have to wait if they were just a routine third class. We're very much involved in aeromedical education. We have some aeromedical education occurring right outside in the hangar. We go to a number of air shows and have the opportunity to talk to airmen. But certainly the biggest thing we do is train our aviation medical examiners. We have some 3,800 aviation medical examiners scattered throughout the world, and we train them initially at Oklahoma City and then hold refresher courses throughout the country in order to make sure they stay up with FAA standards. The Office of Aerospace Medicine is involved very much at research. Most of our research is done at CAMI, our Civil Aerospace Medical Institute in Oklahoma City. And there we do research in such things as survival and evacuation issues. We have a huge human factors division that looks at things like selection and training of air traffic controllers. We look at the issue of fatigue in airmen and flight attendants and air traffic controllers. We have the world's best forensic toxicology laboratory, and following fatal mishaps, we always get specimens and we are able to determine whatever medicine a pilot may have been taking that might show us if there was some medical reason for the crash. We're also developing techniques where we can look at genomes and genetic markers and tell if a pilot was fatigued at the time of the crash. So we have the gold standard forensic toxicology lab there at Oklahoma City, and we learn lots of things. We also are looking into decontamination of aircraft following an infectious illness, emerging illness, or bioterrorism event. And we look at the more common environmental issues associated with aircraft cockpits. We look at the effects of petroleum products that you might be found in the bleed air from our air carriers. We look at the effect of pesticides that we're required to use as we move from country to country and what that residual effect may do to air crew and passengers. And we look at the more common environmental issues like the effects of hypoxia and low humidity and low barometric pressure and radiation and ozone. So we're very much involved in research in the Office of Aerospace Medicine. So that's a few things about our office and what we do. I'd now like to get into some current issues. And talk about how these pertain to you or might pertain to you in terms of maintenance of your medical. Now, the first thing I have up there is the Fair Treatment of Experienced Pilots Act, better known as Age 60. Once again, we're talking about a 121-135 operation, but as many of you are aware, this was certainly a major issue with air transport pilots and commercial pilots until December of 2007, when President Bush finally signed into law the Fair Treatment for Experienced Pilots Act. And I am so thankful. I think all of us at the FAA are thankful that he did that. Otherwise, we would have spent years trying to justify the age 60 rule. As you probably know, since December of 2007, we now allow pilots to fly up to the age of 65. If you fly outside the borders of the United States, in order to be consistent with ICAO, one pilot can be up to age 65 as long as the other one is under the age of 60. If you fly within the continental United States, both pilots can be up to the age of 65. And I'm just glad I'm not spending my life testifying as to why we should or shouldn't have changed that rule, and I'm thankful the president did it with a stroke of a pen. Now, the age 60 rule served us well for many years. It was a rule that stems from 1959, and I don't know how they came up with the age of 60, but I think it was a pretty good stab at a time when commercial pilots should no longer be allowed to carry ticket-carrying passengers. Not to bring up any depressing topic, but as we age, we have physiologic and perceptual motor skills that decline. Our vision declines, our hearing declines, our sleep patterns decline. There are other things that don't work as well when you age, but I'll stop there.
Can I say something about getting 60 more?
Well, could you save it till the end, sir?
Sure.
Okay, and I'd be pleased to have your comment. We've done sophisticated neuropsychological testing, and as you age, you have decrease in attention, you have decrease in memory, you have decrease in speed of processing. So basically, things don't look well as you age. All of that being said, who would not want to fly home with Captain Sullenberger as their pilot in command? So certainly experience makes up for many of the physiologic and the perceptual motor decrement that we all experience. And as I mentioned earlier, I for one think that it's an idea whose time has come. Now, in terms of using best evidence-based medicine in order to determine what is a risk and what's not, in July of last year, the law changed, the rule changed. We now have increased the periodicity of medical certificates for those pilots under the age of 40. If you are under the age of 40 and you have a first class medical, it's now good for a year, vice what used to be 6 months. If you're under the age of 40 and you have a third class medical certificate, it's gone from 3 years to 5 years. And that's simply because we now have good data, we have good medical data that basically tells you the same thing the actuary, the life insurance actuary tables tell you. If you're under the age of 40, the value of a physical in finding something wrong with you it's pretty slim. So we have increased the periodicity for those that are under the age of 40. What's really cool about this new law is that it has a resurrection effect. There are those that had a third class medical that have had their medical expire, and as the passage of this law in July of last year, their medical is suddenly good again. And I think that's nice to have a law that resurrects something of that nature. Now there are a few issues. I know the AMC 700 folks are here making, yep, there they are, keeping an eye on me as usual. You know, every time you sign your 8500 TAC 8 based on a requirement from 10 years ago, a congressional requirement, you give us permission to look at the National Driver Registry to see if you have forgotten to tell us about a DUI. So, when you give us that authority by statute, by law, we are only able to look back 3 years. So, as the people from AMC 700 will tell you, there's a small window of opportunity now that we've increased the periodicity that you could get by with a DUI you'd forgotten to tell us about if you're under 40 and you're in that certain time period. But we're in the process of changing the law. It just takes a long time to change the rules in Washington. You know, I've learned in my time in D.C., in the 5 years I've been in Washington, there's two things in life a man shouldn't have to watch. One is the making of sausage, and the other is rulemaking in Washington. Lastly, I want to tell you that we continue to leverage our aviation medical examiners. We now have 35 medical conditions that once upon a time we expected to be deferred only to the FAA physicians for disposition. We now encourage, we now have programs whereby for anything from heart attack to cancer, once you're approved first time by the physicians, by regional flight surgeon or AMCD, then your AME can look at the specified follow-up and testing and give you your medical certificate. I hope most of you are using FAA MedExpress. This was developed several years ago, and it's been a huge, huge success. Basically, if you have a home email address, you can sign up for FAA MedExpress. You go online and you can fill out the 8500 TAC 8 in the middle of the night in your pajamas at home, where you have all your medical records. You get a confirmation number. Once you're completed with the front of your 8500 TAC 8, basically your medical history, you send that into the electronic netherworld. You take your confirmation number to your AME. He's able to pull that up and finish the backside, the physical part of your 8500 TAC 8, and then send that off electronically. Airmen love it. AMEs love it. If you haven't used FAA Medical Express, I encourage you to do so. I will touch briefly on the hottest thing, the latest thing going at headquarters, and that's our efforts to approve airmen and air traffic controllers that have been depressed and have taken antidepressants. According to the medical statistics, 16% of us sometime in our lifetime are going to have a major depression that's going to require treatment. So I'm talking about something above and beyond reactive depression, like for loss of a job or grieving or something of that nature, but major depression that will require medicine. Now, as you're all aware, major depression has some real side effects that preclude flying an aircraft or controlling aircraft. In addition to the sadness and the mood, you don't think well, you don't make good decisions, you're irritable, your thinking is slowed, your processing is slow, and certainly in the acute phase, depression is incompatible with aviation duties. However, that being said, 85% of all depressions are treatable with antidepressants, and we have good antidepressants now that have much fewer side effects than the antidepressants of old. So we are now soon to be announcing how an airman, first, second, or third class medical airman, can have had a diagnosis of depression, receive the appropriate treatment, take the appropriate medicine, have the specified follow-up and testing, and get back in the cockpit. That's been a program that's been a long time in coming, and I tell you, there's still some details to be worked out, particularly with the air traffic controllers, but soon you'll see published in the Federal Register a new benchmark in terms of a medical condition that we can work with you and get you back up in the air. A part of my life at headquarters in DC is working with Congress, and certainly we work very closely with the House Transportation and Infrastructure Committee. The chair is Congressman Oberstar. Congressman Oberstar is very concerned about falsification as a risk to aviation safety. And as such, he has sent the IG and the GAO to help us, the FAA, figure out how we're going to improve upon this risk to aviation. So Congressman Oberstar has looked at what the IG from DOT and the IG from Social Security did out in Northern California a couple years ago. Some of you are aware that they did an operation out there called Operation Safe Pilot, whereby they looked at Social Security disability records and they compared that to airman medical certificates in the universe of 40,000 pilots in Northern California. And lo and behold, they found a couple thousand out of that 40,000 where people had not only a medical certificate, but they also were collecting Social Security disability. And of that, the U.S. Attorney's Office determined that they wanted to prosecute 50 of the most egregious cases, and they actually identified 48 of the most egregious cases. And of those 48, we're talking about people that had such serious heart disease, and really it was mostly psychiatric disease like schizophrenia and bipolar disorder, but such serious disease that they were collecting 100% Social Security at the same time they were either a first, second, or third class pilot. Needless to say, what showed up on the Social Security records and what showed up on the 8500 TAC 8 were not one and the same. So they prosecuted 48 people. Of the 48 people that they charged, 45 were indicted, two died in the process, and one was so mentally unstable that they dropped charges. So, taking off from Operation Safe Pilot, Congressman Oberstar has asked the FAA to engage in a similar match in disability records. We are certainly, we have made the initial movements to be able to do so. Those of you that read the fine print and read the back of the 8500 TAC 8 will now read that when you fill out your 8500 TAC 8, you need to be aware that by law, these records might be shared with other federal agencies. You will also see a new block on the front of your form that asks if you're collecting any kind of disability. Now, this is not always an easy thing. Being retired military, I'm aware of many people that have a VA disability, and there are other kinds of disabilities other than VA and Social Security, and most of the disabilities that people receive compensation for would allow them to be a pilot, no problem. But your AME should be asking you about that if you put yes in your block for disability. Certainly, we were also charged by the IG that looked into the falsification issue as regards our FAA medical certification. We were charged with educating pilots and aviation medical examiners. So as part of what we were charged to do by Congressman Oberstar, I'm telling you that there are very real penalties to not being as completely honest and forthright on your 8500 TAC 8 as we depend upon you to be. You may or may not have read the fine print that says that you can be fined $250,000 or be put in prison for 5 years or both on these certificates. That was rarely used in the past. However, with Operation Safe Pilot in Northern California and now more recent cases of pilots that were instructor pilots that had insulin-dependent diabetes, this was up in New York, that basically passed out in hypoglycemic coma and had an instructor pilot that successfully landed, forgot to put the wheels down, but otherwise successfully landed, and certainly he ended up in jail for failing to disclose accurate information. So there's very real civil penalties if you're not honest and forthright. And likewise, working with the world-class toxicology laboratory that we have, I will tell you that we not uncommonly learn in fatal mishaps that pilots were on medications that would only be used for disqualifying medical conditions, or in some cases are drugs of abuse, alcohol. In general aviation, we continue to learn that about 8% of fatal mishaps involve the use of alcohol. Alcohol that can be detected that would indicate that pilot was not at his peak in terms of where he needed to be. And it's a significant issue that has stayed stable at that percent of fatal mishaps for many, many years. So, I say this because in the unlikely event that you were involved in a fatal mishap, all those privacy rules that apply to you when you're alive go away. And I can tell you that your insurance company will certainly be interested in the forensic pathology studies that are done as part of our cooperative agreement by law with NTSB. You lose all privacy rights when you're dead, and if you are either under the influence of something that is illegal, or if you were taking medications that you should have reported on your 8500 TAC 8 and did not do so, certainly the insurance companies may not be forthcoming in terms of paying for your airplane or paying your life insurance. And in those cases where there might be other people involved, if you hit a house on the way down and there are other people killed, and then you were found by forensic examination to have not been honest and forthright, certainly any estate you have is going to go to the families of those on the ground and not to your own family. So you need to be truthful on your 8500 TAC 8, and I will remind you again that there is very little reason not to be honest and truthful, because we are perfectly prepared and anxious to work with you. And as I said earlier, only about 0.1% of those airmen that are willing to work with us and get the specified follow-up and testing are ultimately final denied. So there's no reason not to be honest and forthright. And just very quickly, because I want to leave time for some questions, I'll touch on sport pilot, because that's always a big issue at a venue like this. Many of you are familiar with the operational limits of light sport aircraft. Basically, if you are willing to fly low and slow, you can fly a light sport aircraft, and instead of an FAA medical, you can fly with your driver's license, unless your last FAA medical was denied, suspended, revoked, or if for any reason you applied for an FAA medical and didn't get it, you may not use a driver's license. Now, this has disappointed a lot of people, and this is dying down somewhat now, but when we first enacted the light sport rule a couple years ago, it was a big issue because there were lots of older pilots that had been denied an FAA medical 10 or 12 or 15 years ago that had had heart disease or cancer or some medical problem for which they had been denied. And they were chomping at the bit to go get their light sport aircraft and take their driver's license and go fly. And then lo and behold, the law comes out and the rule says, whoops, if you've been denied, you can't do that. So these people were very vocal, very disappointed. AOPA often will bring up the issue as well. And basically, it's the typical American feeling of fairness to all. And I admit, there is a tiny bit of unfairness there. If you take the example of two brothers, they have the same seizure disorder. One applies for an FAA medical and gets denied. The other brother with a similar seizure disorder never applies for an FAA medical. He buys his light sport aircraft. He goes to his private physician, who doesn't practice aviation medicine, and his private physician says, well, Joe, you can drive your car. I guess you can fly an airplane. Well, you hadn't had a seizure in a year. Just take your anti-seizure meds and go have a good time. And he can do so perfectly legally. So one brother's denied and can't fly. The other brother goes and flies absolutely legally. Perhaps that's a bit unfair, but nonetheless, we as federal regulators are charged with not allowing anyone to fly if we know they have a medical condition and would be unsafe to do so. That being said, Most folks with heart disease and cancer and things that they were denied 10 years ago, we now look at those things and routinely special issue almost every kind of cancer just as soon as it's controlled and we know you don't have active disease. Same thing with heart disease. You have a heart attack, a stent, coronary artery bypass grafting, a new valve, you wait a couple of months to rehabilitate, you do a stress test to make sure that there's no ongoing ischemia or lack of oxygen to the heart, and you're going to get your special issuance. So the great majority of those folks that were denied on their last medical need only reapply again, work with us, they'll get their special issuance, and once they get their special issuance, thereafter, they can use their driver's license. So if you're one of those folks, please don't be afraid to work with us. And with that, ladies and gentlemen, I thank you for your attention, and I'll take any questions.
Let's stand. Yes, I'm Martin Sobel. 9 years and almost 2 months ago, I flew my last trip as an airline captain on TWA from Tel Aviv to JFK. The age 60 rule was a result of the introduction of the jet aircraft into the airline fleet in the mid-50s, when the chairman of the board, C.R. Smith of American Airlines, went to his buddy, General Quesada of the FAA, and he said, "I don't want to train these old people. They're going to take too long. Make a regulation." That's how the age 60 rule was put in force. There was absolutely no studies for or against it. Over the years, because the FAA was forced to defend the rule, it took on a life of its own. Now all of a sudden, it was part of your physical aptitude. Half of us never did make it to 60 because we couldn't pass the physical, but those of us could easily fly well past it. Now, ICAO, in their wisdom, allowed pilots to fly to 65, but had a caveat that co-pilot had to be less than 60. Now, just recently, the Congress dragged the FAA screaming and kicking into the 21st century and said, I could fly till I was 65. Now, I missed by a few years, and I found other things to do, include training at flight safety for 4 years before I retired to Sarasota. But that's what happened with the age 60, and I think any attempt to equate that with physical ability is just false.
What's the question?
There was no question. I happened to be walking by, and I heard this baloney about the age 60 rule. And I just want to get that on the record.
I don't know what's baloney, but certainly medical facts are medical facts. And, I think we are all living longer, healthier lives. And to move the age from 60 to 65 is absolutely an idea whose time has come. That being said, you can't deny the fact that as you age, you are more susceptible to sudden or subtle incapacitating medical diseases that could certainly adversely affect the piloting of an aircraft. Just where are you going to draw the line? Certainly there are people that are 80, there are people that are 90, that are still perfectly physically and mentally capable of piloting an aircraft. On the other hand, all of you know people that are less than the age of 60 that for some medical or psychological, psychiatric reason probably shouldn't be piloting an aircraft. It's really a very individualistic science. But I for one am glad that the rule has changed, or else I would be spending much of my life doing testimony as to why we should or shouldn't change that rule. I think there's another hand.
One more question back here, please. Okay.
Ready? Last year I got a survey from Oklahoma on my experience with my medical exam, and nobody else seemed to know about it or heard about it. My doctor didn't know about it. He said, well, that's good that they're checking on us, is what it amounted to. But I was informed about some medical tests that I needed that I wasn't aware of all at once. And I wrote on my little survey, there needs to be a pre-type letter sent out for people like me. And maybe it's the new medical express thing you're explaining that I wasn't aware of, to let the doctor know ahead of time what I'm about to tell him, not in his office. And because some people that would have been active flying would have had to go out and do some medical testing. So is that the form that you're...
Well, with FAA MedExpress is just basically an online form that you can fill out that basically allows you to have all the time you need to complete that form and provide all the medical information that you might not have at your fingertips when you formerly went to your AME's office and you sat out front and just filled it in at the time. Now your AME is not aware of that until you show up with your confirmation number. But certainly the beauty of MedExpress is that you do it at your leisure, it saves you time, you're able to fill out the form with all of the accurate information, and it's really been a great success story with both airmen and with our aviation medical examiners.
Are there any prohibitions with people who have special issuance from using MedExpress?
Oh, absolutely not. Absolutely not. That being said, once you have your authorization, you're going to have a piece of paper that tells you you're going to need to show up with, you know, you're going to have a current status report from your oncologist or your cardiologist, and you're going to have a cholesterol and a fasting blood sugar. You know, that kind of stuff, you'll have a piece of paper to do. But the other part of the history, no reason in the world. In fact, for a special issuance person, there's more reason for you to use MedExpress because you probably have more medical history than someone that might be 21 years old and just learning how to fly. Okay, well, I want to tell you that if you have a specific medical question, we are very fortunate to have a booth just outside, as we do every year. And we have Dr. Carter from CAMI. We have Dr. Northrup and Dr. Barston, both from the Southern Regional Office. And if the computers are up, we have access to all of the medical records that we maintain in Oklahoma City, and we could actually look up your specific medical case if you have specific medical questions. Likewise, if you have specific medical questions, you can certainly corner me after this lecture, and I'd be happy to talk with you about those. Richard, did you have something to say?
Regarding the airman's inquiry, there are times when the airman may get a letter from us that seems to come out of the blue that was unexpected. For example, Raptiva. We sent out letters to all the airmen on Raptiva informing them that we would need an update from their doctor.
That's right. When we get word of something like varenicline that I talked about earlier, or Raptiva would be a newer instance, when the FDA learns that there's good reasons to pull those drugs off the market, we have the means to be able to look at the electronic medical records, and those airmen that reported using that medication were able to get the word out to you and thereby keep not only the national airspace safe, but keep you healthy and make sure you're working with your doctor to get off of any drug that's been found to be hazardous to your health. Are there any other questions? We have one more.
With regard to just what you said, their insurance companies are pushing real hard for people to take generics. Some, and I'm thinking of Lipitor, now has a generic, are AMEs up to date on that, or when do you need to report if you are taking some kind of a generic that may or may not affect you?
Well, unlike the military, where you check with your flight surgeon every time you start a new medicine or you change medicine, in our big, huge civil aviation system, you are only required to list your medications at the time of your next physical exam. And certainly, use of generics is very widespread and has been something that's been in process for a long time. There's certainly no issue at all in terms of your aviation medical examiners asking you about or noting that you're on a generic versus a brand name kind of medication. Okay, well, thank you very much for your attention. I enjoyed talking with you.
Stay right here, we're still on the camera.
Okay.
Dr. Fraser, my AME came out with an excellent suggestion the last time I saw him, and he said we should go to doctors that are schizophrenics. At least we could get a second opinion for free. Any other questions? Come on up. Next show's in half an hour. Here we got one.
I have a question for you.
You bet. Now, do I turn this off here?
They'll get it.
I'm not being recorded now.